8:06 currently. Mostly cloudy skies as I look out the window here at our studios on the corner of Washington Street and North 3rd Street in downtown Wausau. Temperature stands at 41 degrees. I'm Chad Holmes. It is the Thursday edition of the Chad Holmes Show here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Online at bowfallsradio.com. Mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. Big show coming up at the bottom of the hour, just after our bottom of the hour information update of news, weather, and sports at 8:34. It's our Thursday featured NorthStar Knows. We'll be speaking to NorthStar Restoration Services, and every week get a chance to learn a little bit something new and important as we get into the spring season. And this week, we're going to be looking at sump pumps, and we're going to talk a lot about that coming up at 8:34 this morning here on the program. And then coming up in the second hour at 9:34, we're going to be talking to Kara Weiland. She is the widow of Detective Jason Weiland. And of course, I think many of you remember one of the tough days in central Wisconsin in decades. 7 years ago next Friday, March the 22nd of 2017, four people, including Detective Weiland, were killed by a shooter in the D.C. Everest metro area. And obviously, again, it was one of the dark days, but Kara Weiland is a very special person who's doing a lot. And in fact, NorthStar Restoration Services teaming up with Kara and the Weilands for a big special event coming up this summer. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about remembering her husband and more coming up with Kara Weiland coming up at 9:34 this morning on the program. But to start things off, we are joined as we are each Thursday at the start of the show by the host of Up North News Radio, Pat Kreitlow. And Pat, first of all, again, always appreciate you sticking around for a few minutes after your program to join us.
Always my pleasure, and nice to be sounding almost back to normal over here and not quite so froggy as last week. So, you know,
I know the feeling. I know the feeling very, very well. In fact, I know you're a big baseball guy, and I wanted to ask you about Devin Williams to start off with. It was already looking like an uphill battle for the Brewers as we get closer and closer to opening day. That was not good news yesterday, was it?
No, it wasn't. And it's one of those where you can't really, most of the time you can't fault somebody for their injury unless they do it, like, you know, punching a wall, you know, so, or something like that. But, you know, injuries are part of the game. They are part of, you know, the luck that's involved along with all the skill that it takes. And so it's always upsetting when it comes to it, but you also never know. Maybe he was due, you know, for a rough year anyway. Maybe somebody else steps up and is the next big thing. So, yeah, it was rough, but you kind of have to go, well, what's next?
Are you optimistic? I know that spring training doesn't mean a lot, but I can't tell you right now what the record is. But I know when going around the office and hearing Mike Clemens and his sports reports twice an hour, it sounds like every day they're losing. I don't know whether or not that's a misconception on my part, but I got to tell you, I don't know. I can't say I'm overly optimistic when it comes to the crew to start off the season and to add this to that.
Oh, I was never going to be overly optimistic. I feel like last year with Aaron Rodgers leaving the Packers, it kind of taught me to, and I'm not a person who does a lot of meditation, but as I make the finger motions for Zen, I just kind of like pull it all in and say, okay, let's just enjoy the games. And when Craig Counsell left, and you know, when we started seeing pitchers moving, I thought, okay, let's just enjoy the game. If I even get to see the game, because at the time there was rumors a few months back that all the games were going to be moving to like Amazon Prime streaming or Apple TV streaming, and we found out yesterday that nearly all the games are still going to be on Bally Sports, which is good news for cable subscribers like me. So it's just like, look, as long as there is a game, of course I want them to win, but I when you said I'm an optimist, as a baseball fan, you have to be.
Right.
It's like, okay, spring is here. The game I love is being played, and again, you just never know when something's going to click, when something's going to gel. They start putting a few wins together in the regular season, and you know, next thing you know, it's that much more exciting to watch. So, you know, I'm not going to trash things now. It'll be roster moves near the trade deadline and stupid managerial decisions during the game that will get me. But injuries won't do it, and spring training wins or losses won't do it, because I have to be that optimistic.
You are truly a baseball fan. I mean, that's exactly right. And frankly, enjoy the process. Enjoy the 162 game journey that takes us through the summer. And that's the way you sound. Pure baseball. We like that.
The way it's got to be. That's right.
You mentioned the name Aaron Rodgers. I wasn't going to bring it up, but I got to tell you, I was so annoyed yesterday. And again, I mean, it was not annoyed. I was angry. I mean, there's one area that really gets under my skin, and I recall back years ago, When members of the opposition party claimed that when President Obama was talking about those children and tears came to his eyes, that somehow it was a performance art. And then to hear a guy that received so much from this state, and obviously he gave back in terms of performances, but if that CNN story is true, that Aaron Rodgers is going around talking about conspiracy theories when it comes to Sandy Hook, that is like the line that is too far. I never want him coming back in the state, to be honest with you, if that is true.
If that is true, and I always, you know, well, I'll leave a little bit of wiggle room here, but if he is in fact a conspiracy, I mean, he already is a conspiracy theorist, just based on the things that he has said about vaccines and things like that. But and even if he harbors some kind of thoughts about the Sandy Hook massacre, that's something. But if he's actually out there expressing some kind of skepticism about the tragic, you know, terror-filled moments of those children at Sandy Hook, then he has moved into the category of people that I refer to as a garbage person. And that's not to insult sanitation workers. I just mean literally, if Aaron Rodgers is a Sandy Hook truther, he's trash. And I never want to hear about him ever again. Because we're working as hard as we can right now. We're holding on to a civil society by our fingernails. And to not immediately smack down publicly anybody who would harbor these kinds of and spread these kinds of falsehoods and these ugly, ugly thoughts for the sake of advancing some other kind of agenda, then woe to us if we don't call it out and smack it down. So I know it's tough to talk about, right, but honestly, if these reports bear out about Aaron Rodgers spreading this kind of filth, then yeah, as far as I'm concerned, you know, he never existed.
I was listening to you when you were on with Todd yesterday afternoon, and talking about, you know, this was before even that story came out, talking about just that he was on the list with Jesse Ventura for RFK Jr. And the lack of a seriousness is what is, and now, and again, I almost feel dirty talking about, because this is what, you know, it's this big cycle of unseriousness. It's unserious. It's not serious with so many major issues out there to talk about a guy that's currently playing football for the New York Jets and a guy that was a former wrestler who has not been in public office for a couple of decades and floating them as your two leading candidates and everybody jumping on it. I mean, I have been, whether it's the news sites now, the sports sites are all over it, the lack of seriousness. And I thought you kind of hit it on the head yesterday.
Well, in part because right before that appearance on the Todd Alba show, weekdays, noon to 2 here on the Civic Media Radio Network, moments before that, I'd seen an article or a headline about NBA superstar Steph Curry was asked about, apparently he has expressed some interest in running for president someday, and he said he wouldn't rule it out. And again, as somebody who recalls the Jesse Ventura campaign, it is not to say that people who are celebrities can't run for office. It's not to say that all celebrities don't have what it takes. others do. From what I can tell, Arnold Schwarzenegger did a respectable job as governor of California. But those are the exceptions to the rule. And the rule is this. People should be serving in elected office who are actually up for the job and want to take in a sense of curiosity and a base of knowledge to engage in public service. If it's a vanity project, if you think by sheer force of will, because you're a celebrity, you can get things done, then clearly you weren't watching the Donald Trump presidency, one of the least effective presidencies in our lifetime, with the exception of a massive tax cut for millionaires and billionaires. Beyond that, the Trump presidency gave you absolutely nothing. And it's funny, when you go to these Trump rally crowds, and people ask them, well, you know, why do you want Trump? Oh, he did so many great things. And you ask them to explain what, and they're just, they got nothing. They got, because it was just a feeling. Again, it was this celebrity aura about them. And now some people are trying to do that for Robert Kennedy Jr. by way of Jesse Ventura and Aaron Rodgers. You're absolutely right, Chad. It's not serious, and it's beneath the dignity of every responsible voter who thinks that good, qualified, capable people should be serving us in elected office.
And the job involves a lot of hard work. I mean, the idea, and again, I've loved watching Steph Curry for years, but he had to work hard to get to that level on the basketball court. It's not a case where you can just sort of slide into the top job. And that's, again, a frustrating aspect. And even when, I mean, there have been folks who floated Michelle Obama at times. And I thought that was silly as well, because yes, she was there, but it's still not the same. Where, how about running for city council? Huh? I mean, really?
Yeah. You know, where I come back to is another one that's an exception to the rule, was when Hillary Clinton first ran for senator from New York.
Right.
And again, people said, oh, she's just running because she was first lady. And then you actually saw in real time, you watched her doing the homework and doing the work of the job, and then watching her do it as Secretary of State, and then becoming the most experienced and qualified presidential candidate in our nation's history. And all we've proven through her experience is that we do need good people willing to do the homework, but as long as voters are still willing to recognize celebrity over ability, we're going to be in trouble now and then with American elections.
Pat Kreitlow, Up North News, 6 to 8 a.m. every weekday right here on Bow Falls Radio. Pat, thanks again. Have a great day and have a great weekend.
You as well. Thank you.
We'll be right back. Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230.
Said the fight to make ends meet. Keep the man up on his feet.
At home show on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, online at bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. The time is 8:21. Again, our NorthStar Know segment coming up in just a few minutes at 8:34. Again, this week we'll be focusing on sump pump maintenance and more. But first, we got to find out about the weather. As we get closer and closer to the weekend, it's been another warm week here in central Wisconsin. A bit of overcast skies as we begin our Thursday. Temperatures still mild at 41 degrees. But to find out about today and for the next few days, we're joined again from our is it called our weather office? I got myself into a corner there, Brittany Merlot, as Brittany Merlot, our meteorologist, joins us from the Weather Center.
Weather Center.
There you go.
Yes. But, got all my devices and all my barometers here. And
but Brittany, good morning.
Center. How are you? I thought you were going to start singing this morning after the song cut off.
There you go. But
I did.
Oh, geez. Well, that shows, again, we're going to toe tap and start here this morning.
But
exactly.
I know during the course of this week, you've been talking about this point of the week, perhaps getting a little much needed precipitation, but it looks like it did in the winter. I remember in the winter time, there would be some major snowstorms that would hit down south, you know, in the Madison area, the Milwaukee area. They would get the big snow. Well, we wouldn't get much snowfall here earlier during the winter. And now we're expecting a little rain. And again, it's going to be, what, Madison being the drencher, and we're going to be lucky to get maybe a few sprinkles?
Yes, I'm so upset about it because I was really looking forward to, you know, a free car wash from the rain. Let's be real. No, we need every drop of it up here. We have missed out on all of the action of the storms, of the snow, of the rain. South just keeps getting all the precipitation, and that system has slid to the south. They're going to see anywhere from a half an inch to an inch of rainfall. Meanwhile, here for us, Wisconsin Rapids may see some sprinkles from about 10 to 5, and I don't think that we're going to see much at all. Just cloudy skies and a little bit cooler temperatures, still mild, into the low 50s today. We could hit the mid-50s and maybe pockets of sunshine later on as the storm smacks the south and they're drenched and soaked and dreary. So, I mean, I guess we've got a brighter, better day, but we needed the rain.
Meantime, our friend Rob in Tigerton says it's 38 degrees and cloudy, says we need rain badly up here, and said that we had 20 inches of snow on the ground last year when...
Yeah, you remember that?
Yeah, he says, and he asked the question, when will El Nino end, or does it not end?
Oh my goodness, it feels like it never ends, but it is slowly coming to an end here, and it's going to flip to a La Nina as we progress through the spring and into the summer, but the waters are still warm in the Pacific, and we're still feeling those effects of the strong El Nino as it takes the shift, because I'll tell you what, if this El Nino stayed in place for summer, I'd have to move far north because I hate the heat. And what we've been feeling now, could you imagine that much above average in summer? We'd be hitting well into the triple digits almost every day then.
That's a bad chill.
I know. I'm pretty sure we all live here to avoid those.
By the way, you said that that down in Madison may be getting some significant rain. I'm actually driving down there later on to do state basketball this evening. Yeah, is it gonna be heavy rain? Is it gonna be that kind of rain down there in Madison?
It depends when you're going. This afternoon.
This afternoon, early. I'm heading out.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, you're going to hit the heaviest of the rainfall. Thankfully, though, no storms. All the storms, they were in a marginal risk as of yesterday, but they shifted that down south to Illinois as well. So you're going to avoid the large hail risk. Good thing. But just some heavy downpours out there just all day long. Needed rain, though.
And you mentioned as well that we're still above normal and it's going to stay above normal for a little bit. But boy, then we're going to get a little dose of some cold weather by the weekend, right?
Yes, we are. In fact, temperatures will be in the 50s, low 50s today and tomorrow. Then we'll slide down into the upper 40s for Saturday. And that's when the big change hits by Sunday and Monday. High temperatures struggling to get above freezing. Above freezing. Yeah, that's below average.
And our blood is so thin now, we're used to the warmth.
Yeah, we are. We were in t-shirts yesterday.
A year ago or 2 years ago, if you had, you know, mid-30s, hey, it's normal. Yeah, no problem at all. Probably almost feels mild at times. But this time, after getting used to being in the 60s, it ain't going to be anything like that. So you have to get those heavier coats back out Sunday and Monday.
I feel like we're all going to be bundled up, layered up, Michelin man style, and it's not even that bad.
But nobody can complain. Nobody can complain about cold weather. That's the rule right here for 2 days. If you can't handle 2 days in the 30s, then you're in trouble big time. So,
I agree.
All right. What are the details here as we get to the end of the work week and into the weekend?
Yeah. So today we're just going to stay mostly cloudy out there. High temperatures in the low 50s. Winds will be breezy. They could gust up to about 25 miles an hour. Then tomorrow, we'll see abundant sunshine. It'll be pretty decent, still breezy out there, but sunny in the low 50s. Then for Saturday, we'll see more clouds start to build in, the winds start to whip because a quick clipper system swings down from Canada throughout the state. So this is going to bring the colder temperatures for Saturday and Sunday. We could even see some snow Sunday night into Monday as well. As this clipper system moves on in, it's not a big snow heavy one, but maybe half an inch of slushy slop out there.
Very good. Well, I guess we'll, you know, today not bad here in central Wisconsin. Enjoy that and then get ready for, again, a bit of a change. But, again, this time of year, we're going to see some fluctuations. It's going to get warm, it'll get a bit cold. But, yep. Again, we appreciate the information, Brittany. Have a great rest of your Thursday, and we'll talk again tomorrow.
Sounds good. Have a great day, everyone.
That's our meteorologist, Brittany Merlot. Again, right now in downtown Wausau, mostly cloudy skies. Temperature stands at 41 degrees. The winds are out of the north at 6 miles per hour. The dew point is 28, relative humidity of 60%. The barometer at 29.97 inches and a visibility of 10 miles. Don't forget tonight, as I said, I'm heading to Madison a little bit later on as the Marathon High School boys basketball team in the state tournament. Division 4 state semifinals tonight at the Kohl Center. Marathon taking on Kenosha St. Joseph Catholic. We will have live coverage starting with the pregame show at 6:20 and the opening tip-off at 6:35. So again, Marathon against St. Joseph Catholic of Kenosha. Division 4 boys basketball state semifinal tonight live right here on Beaufalls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Online at BeaufallsRadio.com. Mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. And I know that it's on Channel 9 as well, but there's nothing to stop you from having your television on, but turning on your radio or putting on your stream, putting on the Civic Media app, and listen to our broadcast along with the video pictures as well. So, again, we all would win that way. The time is 8:28. Coming up, it will be an information update. Let you know what's going on in terms of news, weather, and sports. We do that at the top of the hour and the bottom of the hour, each and every hour here on Civic Media. Coming up, it will be our weekly Thursday segment, North Star Knows. We're going to be delving in as we get to the spring with sump pumps and maintenance essentials starting things off. But we're going to talk about that and more with North Star Knows, North Star Restoration Services, and their weekly Thursday feature. That's coming up here on Beaufalls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Beaufalls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, BeaufallsRadio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. Every Thursday, second half of the first hour, we turn it over to NorthStar Restoration Services. NorthStar Knows, as every week we will talk about different issues that you may face when it comes to your home and so many other areas. And doggone it, my mind is blanking. Introduce yourselves again.
Oh, come on, Chad.
I had my sheet here and I left
it in
my office.
No worries. No, Chad. Oh. Yeah. It's Jay.
Jay Cricks.
Yep.
And
John Garcia.
Jay, yep. And John. Thank you, guys. Again, we've been on for 2 weeks. We kind of set the foundation, but we're going to start to delve into a little bit deeper now, aren't we, Jay?
We are. And I wanted to take some time just this morning to thank you for the previous 2 weeks of sort of laying the foundation of, you know, who we are as North Star and, you know, the North Star difference and all that stuff. But you know what? It really doesn't matter how much you know until people know how much you care. And that's what I want to kind of focus on over these next couple of segments is, you know, laying out some really good advice for people in the area on how to prepare for some of these things that might be coming our way, you know, this spring, summer, fall, and as we go through this year. So, just again, thanks for having myself and John, and we're really happy to be here, and we're excited about not only this week, but the weeks to come.
It's an interesting time of year. Because it is that big transition from winter into spring, and in a lot of different ways of life, it's a big transition. But boy, especially with homes and structures of any kind, isn't it?
It is. So this year's a little different. We had the winter that never came, so to say. You know, with very limited precipitation this year, the traditional, you know, snowbanks and, you know, the runoff and the melt isn't really happening in our area. Actually, it's really dry actually out there. But we're only one or two big rainfalls away from, you know, flooding and issues and all kinds of stuff. So hopefully we don't have any major issues. But we've got this sort of window of time right now that we normally don't have as Wisconsinites where, wow, we have a really good opportunity to make sure that we are prepared at this point in time. So that's kind of what we wanted to talk about today.
When it comes to preparation, what do people need to be thinking about then? You said it. You got this little opportunity right now.
Yeah.
You don't want to wait until, you know, you're in trouble. What should people be thinking about at this point then in terms of being prepared?
So there's many facets to preparedness. And it really depends on what's happening. So there could be something, a bunch of things around the house that you can be doing. And John will talk on some of that stuff. There might be some financial things you might want to think about and prepare for and kind of look at, you know, your home holistically, not just as the actual box that you live in, but, you know, there's a lot of different elements. And John can kind of talk about some of the preparedness things that you might want to think about around your home and things that you might want to get done prior to any major rainstorms coming. So, John?
Yeah, so obviously now everyone's kind of in spring cleanup mode. So one of the things that you can do is make sure that all your gutters are cleaned out, the downspouts aren't clogged, make sure your downspouts are extended properly. If you have any pipes pushing the water away from your foundation, mm-hmm. it's good to make sure that those are connected, not laying there loose. Sometimes they get knocked around from either snow, ice. Another thing is check your grade around your foundation and make sure that, you know, from the winter time until now, you didn't get any sinking basically next to the foundation that might cause water to run right directly towards your foundation. You want to make sure that the water is running away from your foundation to limit the amount of water intrusion, the amount of water getting into your drain tile if you have drain tile. Some older homes don't have drain tile. Another good thing to check is look at the trees around your house. You know, after winter and snow building up on the branches, mm-hmm. sometimes large branches do crack. So make sure that those are taken care of. If any look a little worrisome, make sure they get cut down so they're not falling on your roof, causing damage to your gutters. On the flip side, if you don't have gutters on your house, this might be a good time to look at potentially getting some gutters installed so that you, when this water, this rain does come, you're not having to worry about all this water intrusion in your basement.
Let me ask a question just based on what you were just saying. You're talking about a foundation, making sure the water is going in the right direction. What happens if you find out, hey, there's something that is not quite right here? And obviously not as somebody who's not an expert, what is the next step?
Yeah, so, I mean, really the cheap and easy way is to bring in some fill and basically build up that top layer of soil so you can get it to pitch away. Getting some grass seed on it, obviously, so you can get some grass to grow to, because that way when the rain's coming down, you don't want it to just get divots in it and kind of wash away. You kind of want it to really grasp in there and get a good bed of grass to hold it all together. So mm-hmm. just basically getting it filled in with dirt so that way it'll pitch away. So if you do get water coming in, you know, especially wind-driven rain, even if you have large eaves, you're going to get water underneath them. So making sure when the water does hit, it's at least trying to push away from the house.
Again, we're talking to Jay Cricks and John Garcia. NorthStar Knows every Thursday morning right here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230 with NorthStar Restoration Services. You also mentioned a financial aspect, being prepared financially. What did you mean by that?
Well, before we dive into that part, I think there's still some more stuff that we can kind of talk about around the house. Mm. You know, one of the biggest, I guess we'll call it your first line of defense. A lot of homes here in central Wisconsin have a basement.
Yep.
And most basements have either one or two sump pumps in them. Mm. And if you haven't changed out your sump pump and you just sort of rely on Old Faithful, it might be a good opportunity right now, before we get any major rain, to take a look at your sump pump pit. Make sure that it's functioning. Make sure that it's just not sitting down there idle. So test it. Make sure that the pit itself is free and clear of any debris. Those are also some really big things that you want to make sure, because a lot of older sump pumps almost have like a plunger that kind of goes up and down, or maybe something that rides on like a rod where it slides up and down. Make sure that nothing's inhibiting that, because it might be a perfectly working fine sump pump, but something could be down in the pit hanging that up from functioning. So that's one thing that you might want to check in regards to your sump pump. And last week, I was at a home inspection doing a walk around for a realtor. They had a prospective buyer, and this home had two sump pumps. These sump pumps were running every 2 to 3 minutes. They both were pumping water out of the basement, because this home was lower topography where it was laid, you know, located. It was kind of like one of the homes, not at the bottom of the hill, but a lot of the ground thaw and moisture was running towards this home. And standing outside of the house, you could see these sump pumps kicking on every 2 to 3 minutes. And as John had mentioned, if there's extension, you know, pipes or something like that, getting the water away from the home, that's great. But one of these pipes had like a coupler that was leaking. And every time the sump pump would spray, would turn on, this coupler would just spray water all over the side of the house. You know, basically that water was just running straight back down the foundation, right back into that sump pump pit and getting recycled back out, creating this cycle.
Yep.
So the sump pump was working fine, but the water wasn't being ejected far enough away from the home and running across the property. So it was just doing this continuous cycle. So those are some small things that you're going to want to, you know, check on.
Right.
Also, if your sump pump hasn't been swapped out or changed in 2, 3, 4, 5 years, just because it's good old faithful,
right,
the last thing you want to do is swap out your sump pump when it's flooding. You want to swap that thing out before you have any issues, sort of preventative maintenance, and just make sure that you are in a position so you're prepared for when something happens. I'd rather be doing something up front or ahead of time than reacting to a disaster, because that's just going to make it so much worse. Everything's more compounded, you know, when you're reacting to it rather than being proactive and putting some other measures in place. And John, speaking of sump pumps, there are several options when it comes to having a backup or just sort of maintaining your sump pump and your preparedness.
Yeah, so one of the things you can put on a sump pump is a battery backup. So if the power does go out, at least the battery backup will kick on and give you, and it obviously depends on how much water is coming in and how many times that pump is turning on. Battery is obviously not going to last forever. So, you know, if you do have a battery backup, it might be a good idea to either A, do you have a generator? B, do you have another battery that you can swap out if that one were to die? It's just a good idea to have that in place. And Jay could probably talk about, as far as insurance policy goes, why it's a good idea to have that as well.
Oh, real quickly as well.
Yeah.
It sounds like these are a lot of things that a homeowner or whoever's, you know, in charge of the house can do on their own to, you know, maintenance and make sure you're ahead of the curve. Like the old sports theory is, you know, make a trade, but a year too early than a year too late.
Yeah.
But if you get to the point where you do need maybe a little bit more help, what's maybe the level that, you know, maybe we get those professionals in before I get myself literally underwater?
So when it comes to replacing a sump pump or any of those plumbing sort of chores or tasks, those are not services that we directly provide. But we do have several strategic partners in the area that respond very quickly when we call them. So it's much different than being a homeowner and just going through the phone book or going on Google and trying to get a plumber to respond. We've got dedicated, you know, strategic partners that when we call them, they're like, okay, we'll go, let's get it done. So it's really nice to have those partnerships right here in the community that when something does happen, we can get a contractor over there really fast. And kind of going back to that sump pump thing, I've got a friend who is also a multi-time client who's hired us several times, and I'll just call him SS. And you know who you are if you're out there listening today. And he's had his basement's flooded 3 times. Mm. And the first time it flooded, he had no idea that he needed a battery backup, so he went and got a battery backup, got multiple battery backups, and his basement flooded again. The battery backups died. And he's like, well, I did everything I was supposed to do. I've got the sump pump, I've got the battery backups, and the power was out for so long that the battery backups just died. And he didn't have access to a generator. So what he ended up doing is he installed what's called a water-driven sump pump. And it works on the same basic principles as a siphon. So once it kicks on, the water flowing through it draws the rest of the water out of the sump pump crock, which is a really cool feature if you don't have access to power. So he's got his regular old sump pump that runs off of, you know, regular power on the house. And if the power goes out, he's got a water-driven sump pump that runs off of city water pressure. So as long as you've got water pressure in your home, your water-driven sump pump will also stand as a backup, which is sometimes a much better option than a battery backup with a generator, because typically if the power is out, you still have water pressure. Now, if it's a farmhouse with a well pump, things like that, it might not be such a good option because that does require power. But just something to think about, depending on where you're located. This SS, we'll say, lived over in Kronenretter, where the water table is a little higher and it's very sandy. And he ended up doing the water-driven sump pump, and it works like a charm. He said it's saved his butt several more times, and he's like, I don't need to call you anymore. And I'm like, that's glad. I'm really glad that you don't need to call
SS
us
was
anymore.
Probably thinking he was a little snake bit there for a little bit, right? Three times? I mean, exactly. Holy cow. And by the third time, I was wondering maybe, you know, how close of friends are you going to be after all this work that you're doing now?
So there's a lot of things that we can do as homeowners. You know, like John was mentioning before, make sure your downspouts and gutters are clean and clear. The downspouts are getting the water away from the home. The further, the better, obviously. If you can get past 3 feet, with a pad, great. Put in those six footers to get that water far away. Mm-hmm. You know, make sure your grading is done. Make sure your sump pump's in good working order. Just a lot of little things that we don't normally think about until it's too late. You know, I know a lot of people lift up their gutter extensions in the wintertime for snow blowing purposes, and just those little things that you want to make sure that you're putting that stuff back in place and getting all your safety measures, you know, ready to go for when it does rain. Not if it's going to rain. It will rain. We are going to get some heavy rain, I feel. You know, we're in this El Nino weather pattern. Right. And what I've been reading about is, you know, yes, we had that nice warm winter, but that moisture somewhere. And we're looking at a humid, wet summer. And it's just a matter of time.
We got about a minute before a break, but I guess a final point here about sump pumps. And what you've been talking about is the importance of being proactive.
Yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
not waiting. And I think that's sort of been underlined by what each of you have been saying.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, you want to just get all this done ahead of time. And now is a great time. We've had great weather. You know, it doesn't look like we have any rain in the close forecast here. So even this weekend, you know, get out there, check everything, check your gutters, make sure everything's flowing properly, mm-hmm. Nothing's clogged. Just a great time to get out and do it.
We're going to take a quick 1 minute break and then come back more with Jay Cricks and John Garcia. Again, every Thursday, North Star Knows, and we look at different areas that can save you time, can save you money, can save you a lot of stress as well. So we have more to come. We're going to talk a little bit about, you know, being here in Wisconsin. It's not like being in San Diego where it's like one season. Things right. change a lot, and how does that affect what you have to think about? We'll talk about that and more coming up in a minute. Again, it's North Star Knows here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. And welcome back, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. North Star Knows with North Star Restoration Services, Jay Cricks and John Garcia. And we were just talking during our one-minute break about some rather simple ways you can make sure that you are ahead of that potential emergency in terms of making sure that sump pump is working properly.
Yeah, so if the obviously a lot of our sump pumps aren't activating right now because we might live a little, you know, a little bit higher up, or the water table might be lower in our area. Obviously some people's sump pumps are running nonstop right now because they might be, you know, at the bottom of a hill or in a valley somewhere. So you can see it, it's working. So John, how would somebody that doesn't have a sump pump that's activating right now, how would they go about testing their sump pump to make sure that it's actually working?
So if your sump pump has a cover, you're going to want to take the cover off, get a few gallons of water, pour it into the sump pit. Obviously, like Jay said before, make sure it's cleaned out. But there's a float inside there, and that float's going to lift. And when it lifts, it's going to turn on the pump. And if the pump turns on and the water starts getting sucked out, you obviously know it's working. When the pump shuts off and it's done, you want to make sure that water isn't coming back down into the pit. If it is, that means your check valve probably has some issues. So you need to take a look at that. So the check valve basically allows water to go one way, and then it closes so it can't come back into the crock. And so you're going to want to check that, make sure it's not seized up. It is a pretty easy piece to change if you need to. You can run to Menards, Home Depot, grab one to swap it out. So just a really quick and easy way to test it ahead of time, just so if it's not running, you're going to verify that it will run when the water does come in.
Yeah.
One other aspect about flooding that obviously needs to be discussed as well is the insurance aspect.
Yeah.
And, to be prepared in that case as well. What should folks be thinking about there?
So it's a very dynamic conversation. We could go on for quite some time. But the nuts and bolts revolve around, you know, making sure that you've got the right coverage. So when we arrive on site, that's not the time to find out that you're not properly covered. Right. Just like, you know, when the sump pump fails, it's not the time to find out that your sump pump was outdated. You want to get ahead of these things. So as the sump pump is your first line of defense, so to say, of stopping the water or, you know, capturing the water and pumping it out, your insurance or your insurance agent that you work with is also a primary aspect that you want to focus on. Over the years, insurance policies have been changing considerably. There's limited coverages. There's additional riders that are needed. So if water does come in through your sump pump crock, that's typically a rider that you need on your insurance policy. It's usually not covered on your basic homeowner's policy, okay? Mm-hmm. And there's usually coverage limits, typically $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, or $20,000 in coverage. And you might not need a whole lot of coverage for a very basic concrete bunker of a basement. You know, if it's just unfinished and you don't really do a lot down there, there's not a lot of building materials or contents, and it's just one of those areas that you've got a few shelves and some stuff up on some shelves, you probably don't need a lot of insurance coverage. You know, a couple $1,000 to clean and sanitize the basement and pump the water out, and you're probably good to go. If you're like me and you've got a fully finished basement with, you know, a couple of bedrooms and a laundry room and, you know, a lot of, you know, stuff in the basement, mm-hmm. you might want to check to see what your coverage limits are. So for example, you've got, say your kitchen sink overflows or your toilet on the main level of the home overflows. That water, you know, goes down from the main level of the home down into the basement. That's usually always covered by your insurance, okay? When water backs up through your sump pump crock, that is a different ball game altogether. So do you have a set coverage amount? Is it a $500 deductible? Is it a $1,000 deductible? Is it a $2,000 deductible? Is it a 1% deductible? Is it a 2% deductible? Mm. These are all things that you're going to want to know, because these are big numbers. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people don't have that money just laying around. So you're going to want to have these questions answered by your insurance agent way ahead of time. The last thing you want to find out is having the adjuster at your home and telling you, well, this isn't a covered loss, or you don't have the right insurance for this. And then we're there going, okay, we can still help, but now all of this is coming out of pocket. Mm-hmm. You know, we're still willing to help and we're still willing to work with you, but it can be a financial burden on somebody if they're not properly prepared mm-hmm. by asking the right questions to their insurance agent. So you've got two sides to the insurance world. You've got the agent who sells you the policy, and then you've got the adjuster who then shows up and then helps interpret the policy when they're on site. And they both work for the same company typically, but they're on different sides of the spectrum. One is there to, you know, bring in revenue. One is to make sure revenue is not going out the door, paying for things that aren't covered underneath the policy. They're same badge, same, right. same shirt, that, you know, same company, but different ends of the spectrum. So those are some really big questions that, as a restoration contractor or a builder, we can't answer those for you. We're not on that side. We can help out any way, shape, or form you need us to, but the last thing you want is a fully finished basement with a $5,000 sump pump rider, and that's barely enough to clean the water up and maybe dry the basement down. So when it comes to coverage limits and knowing how much insurance you need, it's typically based on the basement and how well it's finished out. And John can kind of speak to what you would kind of want to look for coverage limits if you were to have a sump pump failure and water comes up your well crock or backs up into your home. So John, kind of want to help people out here a little bit?
Yeah, so a few things obviously to look at is what type of flooring that you have in your basement. Is it carpet? Or is it a vinyl plank? Is it a epoxy floor? Because that's going to determine your, you know, what kind of coverage you want. Also, is it drywall on the walls, or do you have car siding, basically pine tongue and groove or cedar tongue and groove? Really look at your finishes. Is your bathroom down there, is it just a fiberglass shower, or is it a tile shower? Mm-hmm. Is it a jetted tub? Is it a standard tub? So all of these things play into when you're going to talk to your insurance to decide, you know, how much coverage you're going to need is based off of the materials that are down there. Because if it's already set up a certain way, you're going to want it back that way. So you don't want to short sell yourself on what you have down there. So just look at your finishes. Make sure that you're getting the appropriate amount of coverages for those areas.
I guess the bottom line is we're in our last 45 seconds. It sounds like preparation is so important. I mean, to it be is. Thinking ahead, that not to wait till you guys or the insurance guys or anybody else is in the door with a major problem.
There is. Yeah, there's a lot you can do around the house yourself, but then you need to lean on some professionals and find out if you are properly covered.
And to contact and to find out more about NorthStar, again, best places to look.
Yeah, give us a call, 715-302-0529. You can reach out to us on our Facebook page. Or just, go to our website at northstar365.net, and you can send us a message that way as well. So we're really easy to get a hold of, and we get back to people as fast as possible.
Jay Cricks, John Garcia, we'll see you next week.
Awesome.
We'll see you then. Thank you.